Good morning, Parkway. Same here. I know that you thought the last time you would see me was on last week, Sunday. But I couldn't leave without one more last goodbye and hello to our first-time visitors. If it is your first time here visiting with us, welcome to Parkway. Here at Parkway, we are family. We want to reach out, connect, and answer any questions you have about us. So text the word welcome to the number below and stick around after church because there are a lot of great people who want to get to know you better. Check out some of our upcoming events.
Nursery care is available during service for infants and toddlers under the age of 3. Just let one of the greeters you met at the door know, and we'll direct you to where the nursery care room is located. Summertime small groups have started and will continue over the next 7 weeks. Small groups take the place of midweek Bible study and are offered on both Wednesdays and Thursdays at 6:30 p.m. Currently, there are 4 families hosting, so check out the Church Center app for a listing of at-home small groups and request to join at a neighborhood near you. See Taylor or Pastor Jamie to get plugged into a small group or for more information.
This Saturday, on July 16th, is the next men's group meeting here from 9:30 to 10:30 a.m. The men are still studying the pursuit of God. Guys, come out and join us this Saturday. Feel free to reach out to my dad, Matt, for more details about our men's ministry here at Parkway.
If you're interested in supporting those vulnerable in our community, Parkway Salt and Light Family Advocacy Ministry will host a FAM orientation on Saturday, July 23rd from 10:30 to 11:30 in the Fellowship Hall. This is for anyone who missed the orientation in June, or for those who want more information about the FAM ministry before getting plugged in. And for those who attended a FAM orientation and want to support foster families as a part of a care community, the care community training will be held on Sunday, July 24th, right after the English service at 12:15 in the Fellowship Hall. Everyone can be an agent of change, so come join us and get ready to make an impact in our community while bringing glory to God.
This month at Parkway, we have Vacation Bible School from July 25th through the 29th, from 6:30 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. nightly. Ages pre-K to 6th grade are welcome to come out and have fun with the Holy Land Adventure and visit the Jerusalem Marketplace.
Remember, you can give online on the Church Center app or drop off your tithes and offerings in the box at the back of the church. And I also want to give a big thanks out to my Parkway family for always being so supportive. Now, I won't say I can't wait because I did just talk about patience, but I will say I look forward to seeing you all on my first break back home from college. Now, sit back, relax, and get ready for the preached word today. It will help you find your life and purpose in Jesus.
All right. Just want to say, as you turn to 1 Peter, which is where we'll be for the next 13 or 14 Sundays, that small groups have started, and we started out with our first lesson from Preacher Sam, his sermon, talking about patience. And so if you missed last week and you want to get started with small groups this coming week, you're going to start out with lesson 1 in this new study. So this will be fresh, you haven't missed a thing, and you can get plugged into a small group. Now, I will tell you, there is one small group that is better than the rest. That's the one that I'm in at the Sakelik's home. So you can join us there. No, we don't want to hear from David.
We have a pool with our...
Oh.
And she has
bears. Yes. Wildlife is what we say, yes. And it's not just the kids that are there that are part of the zoo. Yes. So if you want to go swimming and do the Bible study while you're swimming, I guess. Yeah. So that's a deterrent from the Clark. Oh, okay. Do some dunking there. Yeah. Well, I do encourage you to sign up for a small group. You can either use the Church Center app to do that. There's the paper in the back. You can sign up. We'll get you connected. Or you can just show up at somebody's house, and they'll sign you up on the spot. So there's plenty of ways you can get connected into a small group. You know, we've got people from, you know, off Bristol Road, the Knoxville area. We've got, you know, right around the church, and we've got over on Spriggs Road. So wherever you are, if you're like, hey, those aren't convenient, that's fine. You start a small group in your house, and we'll start advertising that people can go to your house too. So you can get connected to a small group. So this Sunday, what we're going to do is we're going to start out with the introduction to our series called Exiles. And we get this from the first couple of verses in 1 Peter chapter 1, which is where we're going to be. And usually introductions are not the most exciting sermons in a sermon series, but it's going to lay all the groundwork we need to understand what Peter is talking about in the book 1 Peter. So that when we get later on in the book and we're like, whoa, that sounds kind of odd that he's talking about how women should behave and act and do those kind of things, well, we've got to go back to why he's writing the book and who Peter is and what his purpose is and who his audience is. And so we've got to kind of point ourselves back to this kind of as our North Star, these opening verses. And so in the scripture, it says to us at the very beginning in verse 1, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, the elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace be multiplied. Now I'll tell you here at the beginning of our study together that 1 Peter is probably one of the more practical books of the New Testament, meaning you're not going to think a lot about, you know, theories. This is just where the rubber meets the road. Hey, husbands, do this. Hey, children, do this. Wives, do this other thing. Hey, Christian, don't say those kind of things. Christian, don't think about these kind of things. Christian, think on these things. And so the book is very practical in that it's going to lay out for us kind of the do's and don'ts of what it means to be a Christian, a Christ follower. And so as we go through it, we're going to answer some of the questions that maybe you have on your own mind and heart, directly or indirectly, in 1 Peter. And so I'm going to speak to you for just a moment from a pastoral level and tell you that I get a lot of these questions from time to time. And I wrote down some of the kind of things that people will ask me from time to time. Somebody might say, you know what, Pastor, I'm going through a difficult time health-wise, and you know, my wife is going through a difficult time health-wise, and we're taking care of elderly parents. How can we find the strength, you know, to keep on going? Or somebody comes to me and says, you know, Pastor, I have found that I've just been watching a lot of, you know, Netflix, and I've been sitting on the couch watching TV, and I've developed this habit of just becoming a couch potato. Can I break the habit? Or somebody comes to me and says, hey, Pastor, you know, I've kind of realized that I'm a hypocrite in a lot of areas. You know, I've kind of shown myself to be like this, but I really am like this. And can I change? And can I become the person that God wants me to become? Or a person comes to me and says, you know, when everything goes wrong in my office, my job, in the classroom, I get the brunt of it all. You know, the rebuke flows my way. And I think it's really just unjust. What can I do about it? Or somebody comes to me and says, hey, Pastor, my husband doesn't really want to follow Jesus. He kind of makes fun of my faith. And so I don't know what to do. And in fact, what I've decided to do is I've crocheted napkins and placemats with Bible verses. And I write Bible verses in the steam in the mirror, you know. And so is that what I'm supposed to do? Or a person comes to me and says, Pastor, you know, I'm at my job and every Friday everybody goes to the bar and that's where all the social things happen. Is it wrong for me to go there and just kind of get a seltzer water? Or, Pastor, you know, I come from a church where there's a committee for everything, And there's a committee on committees, and so I really don't know where I should get plugged in here at Parkway. How do I begin? Or somebody comes to me and says, you know, Pastor, I've been reading this book about the end times, and I think I found out who the Antichrist is. You know, I've been sitting down and really thinking about it. Disney, D-I-S-N-E-Y, that's six. Donald, D-O-N-A-L-D, that's six. Mouses, M-O-U-S-E-S, that's six. That's 666, Pastor. I think the Antichrist is Mickey Mouse. And am I right, you know? So somebody will come to me about that. Now, some of those are varying from, you know, on the silly to on the serious, but those are the kind of practical questions that people will come and ask, you know, their pastor from time to time. And usually what's followed up with those kind of practical questions is there a book or a teaching or something where I can learn a little bit more about this subject so that I can get an answer to my question? And the answer is usually yes. There are a million books and a million different perspectives, a million, you know, especially with the internet now, if you want to pull up teaching on a particular subject, it's out there. You know, just go on YouTube or go to Google, and you'll find somebody who has tried to answer the question you're dealing with. But the more that I see these kinds of problems crop up and these practical issues, the more it concerns me that we're looking for somebody else's answer to the question without first going to the source, which is the Word of God, and seeking out God's truth for ourselves, and then seeking out the advice and counsel of others. You are a royal priesthood. You have been given the Word of God, and you have been given the Holy Spirit that illuminates the Word for you. You don't need a priest or a pope to tell you what God's Word says. The Holy Spirit and the Word together will help you know what the Bible says. And when you have these practical issues of life come up, what do I do in my marriage? What do I do with my kids? What do I do in my job? The Word of God will shine a light into those areas. And you should be a person of the book, seeking out God's truth on your own. But I have been convinced over the last several years that we don't want to study things for ourselves. You know, even if I told you, hey, here's the book, go read it for yourself, you're going to look at me and say, Pastor, can you whittle down the chapter that my question is answered in within the book? And then you're going to say, you know what, the chapter is like 12 pages. I mean, I can't read all of that. Can you show me the paragraph where my answer is found? And you say, yeah, that's 6 to 8 sentences. I don't know if I can do that. Can you show me the sentence that my answer is found? And you say, Pastor, you know what, you keep the book. Give me a bumper sticker slogan, you know, something akin to love God, love people. That I can get behind. I mean, you just need to tell me now, tell me simply, and I don't want to think about it. You just give me the answer. Do you see there's a great danger in that? That is something that Satan can use for error to come into your own heart and life, where you're listening to a myriad of different voices, but you have not sat to listen to the voice of God speaking through His Word for yourself. And what happens is Christians can go astray by these false teachings. I was watching snippets of Tom Hanks' movie a few years ago where he played Captain Sully, you know, the plane had, you know, birds had taken out both engines, and he had to miraculously land inside the Hudson River, if you remember the story. And as I was watching snippets of that, you know, it's kind of amazing. He only had like 218 seconds or something like that from the time the engines went out, he shut down the computers, and all that he was left with was his instinct, his knowledge, and the good Lord. You know, that's all he was left with. But on board that airplane was a system that rivaled everything that we sent to the moon the first time, with a backup system, with a backup system, with a backup system. And when the engines went out, the backup systems and the main system was no good. All he had was his instinct. And I'll tell you, give it 20 years, and we'll have a new generation of drivers that don't know how to drive a manual vehicle. And when I say manual, I don't mean a 5-speed stick shift. I mean a steering wheel. You know, the car will be automated. And you'll say, well, I've never had to manually drive a car in my life. I wouldn't even know how to begin. And when the car goes awry, they don't know what to do. Christian, let me just tell you, we are in danger that when the systems begin to fail and the technology goes away, what are you left with? You're left with yourself, the Holy Spirit, and the Word of God. Are you prepared to weather the storm when it's you and Jesus? Or are we too reliant on the voices of others to speak to us, rather than relying on the voice of God to speak to us? And we are in danger as Christians to become automatic pilot Christians, just cruising along in our Christian faith, saying, Pastor, give me the bumper sticker slogan, give me the 3 points of the sermon, let me feel good about coming to church, and let's move on. Don't disrupt the ship. You know, keep it steady, keep everything smooth. Christian doctrine is important only in so much as it, you know, helps excite me. You know, I think about the cross, or I think about, you know, my salvation. You know, spending time thinking about what is sanctification, how that works, or what is justification, or any other kind of truth. You know, those are just boring things. Those are things for super Christians to study, and theologians and pastors. Just give me the bottom line. That's all I need. I'll tell you that if you're in a rut in your Christian walk, the most exciting thing you can do to reinvigorate your walk is to find out, what is sanctification? What is justification? How does it work? How has God laid out this plan of salvation? How does God work? How does God see things and orient things? And how does His providence work and His foreknowledge? And when you get deep in the truths of the Word of God, you'll get excited about what God is about, and you will have a new joy and a replenished spirit because you're about the things that God is about, and you're learning more about who God is. The blessed truths of the Scripture are not there as, you know, boring ancient anecdotes. They are the life source for the believer. And as we study 1 Peter together, let us be found like the Bereans, who it is said of them that they were more than the others, people of the book, that when they heard what was preached, they immediately sought the Scripture to determine whether it was true. They were not Christians who came to church for a spoonful of sugar and then they went home. They were becoming people of the book. They didn't want bumper sticker theology. They wanted to know what the Bible said, and they wanted to know how to live it out. They wanted the depth of the truth of God's Word for themselves. And this letter is written so that we might know the depths of what it is to live the Christian faith. We understand the purpose of the letter because Peter actually spells it out. You will find this about the letter here, 1 Peter. He does not leave much to the imagination. He tells us very plainly what he is doing. If you'll look in 1 Peter chapter 5, you'll see the reason why he wants us to read and understand this letter. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 12. But Silvanus, some of your translations say Silas, Silvanus, our faithful brother as I consider him, I have written to you briefly for this reason, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God in which you stand. In other words, he's written for encouragement, to encourage us that this is what grace is, this is what grace means, this is how you live it out, to exhort us to live out and live our lives in the grace of God, and to be able to stand fast in our understanding of the grace of God. That's the reason why he wrote the letter. Who wrote it, though? Who's the author? That's a good question. And Peter, again, doesn't leave much to the imagination. If you go back to 1 Peter chapter 1, he begins the letter, as most first century letters begin, with the name of the person who wrote it first. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. So who is this writer? Now, this morning, if I was to play a word association game with you where I said a word and then you said something that associates with it, like, for instance, if I said donuts and you would say Krispy Kreme and you'd be right, you know, that kind of thing. Best fast food, Chick-fil-A. Yes, you got it. So the reason we can, you know, do those things is because we would all kind of be on the same page, right? But there would be various opinions if I shouted out, Peter, and then you would have a myriad of different things. And so I wrote down just a few things that came to my mind when I thought about associating Peter, you know, with kind of who he is. And so the first stop my mind took me to was Peter learning what obedience is. And if you remember in Luke chapter 5, Peter and the other disciples, the fishermen, have been out on the boat and they haven't caught anything. Remember the story? And Jesus, who is a teacher of the law, a rabbi, he kind of is standing at the shore and he says, hey, guys, just put the net on the other side. And Peter, he kind of, in Peter fashion, speaks first, thinks later. He says, hey, we've been out here all night. You know, you're just a teacher of the law. I'm a fisherman. You know, who are you to tell me what? And I kind of am reading between the Bible lines for a moment. I think he caught the eye of Jesus, and Jesus probably gave him the same kind of look that your mom might have given you when you started to talk back. The look I have seen my wife give my kids on a number of occasions. It scares me when she gives the look. And so, I think, you know, he's kind of spouting off, and then he kind of thinks after, like, this probably isn't a good idea. He says, hey, we've been out here all night. We haven't caught anything. Okay, but we'll put it on the other side, you know. And you know the rest of the story. He puts it on the other side, and the nets are so full, they're about to break. Peter had to learn obedience while he was on the boat. That's kind of where my first thought went to. And then I thought about Peter learning about faith while he was walking on the water. And you may remember the story. It's in Matthew 14. In Matthew 14, Jesus is walking on the water, and Jesus actually says, hey guys, it's me, it's Jesus. And Peter says, hey, if you're really Jesus, tell me to come out there. He says, well, come on. And the Bible says Peter walks on water. And then the Bible says he's walking on water toward Jesus until he starts to get his eyes on everything else going around him, the boisterous wind and the waves. And when he does that, he gets his eyes off Jesus and onto the things going on. He begins to sink. And he says, save me, help me. And immediately the hand of Jesus reaches out and pulls him up. And I think about Peter learning what it is to have faith, to keep his eyes on Jesus, not on the problems of this world, and all those things we think about in Matthew 14. And then I think about this writer, Peter, in John chapter 18, in a very heroic moment. You know, John 18 begins, Jesus is in the garden, and he has been betrayed by Judas with a kiss, and a legion of Roman soldiers have come to arrest Jesus, try him, and ultimately crucify him. And in that moment, Peter takes out a dagger, and you know the story. As he takes it out, he wants to defend Jesus with this little dagger, and he cuts off the ear of a guy named Malchus, and Jesus performs his last miracle on earth before the resurrection, probably the smallest miracle he's ever performed, because all that Peter really cut off, we believe, the way that the Bible talks about it, is just like the ear lobe, a small little piece of the ear. And it's really cosmetic. You know, the Malchus can hear just fine, but Jesus wants him to restore him to exactly who he was before he met Peter. And so Peter is in that moment in the garden where he's kind of standing tall. I'll defend you. You know, I'm even with my dagger, I'll defend you to the end. And if you just walk your eyes down in John 18, we go from the garden to the courtyard. Jesus is being tried, and Peter is around this fire. And this person says, "Hey, I think I know you. Are you a disciple of Jesus?" And this is Peter's moment to rise tall again, to say, "You know what? Yeah, I know who Jesus is. He's the Savior of the world." After all, Peter's already proclaimed this. You remember, along the road to, I think, Jericho, they pull off to the side after a little while, and Jesus looks at him and says, "You know, who do the people say that I am? Hey, you're Elijah, you're a prophet. But who do you say that I am?" Peter says, "Thou art the Christ." And yes, that's it. This is his moment to now say it to the unbelieving world. "Yes, I know who Jesus is. He's the Messiah. He's the Christ." After all, Jesus had already told Peter in the upper room, "You're going to betray me. You're going to deny me." And Peter said, Jesus, you've got it wrong. The whole world might fall apart, but I will never deny you." Jesus says, "Listen, you're going to deny me before the rooster crows." The person around the fire says, "Hey, aren't you one of his disciples?" And rather than telling the truth, he tells a lie and he says, "No, I am not." And a little girl says, no, "I think I've seen you in the crowds. Yeah, you've been, no, I'm not." And then a Roman soldier, you know, who's related to Malchus, who obviously this story has gotten around that night. "Hey, did you hear about Malchus? Yeah, he has his ear cut off. There's blood everywhere. Jesus picked up his earlobe and put it right back on. It's crazy." The stories went around. Who did it? Peter, you know, the fisherman guy. He's dead to rights. Eyewitness almost. Peter still looks at him and says, "No, I don't know him." Of course, the rooster crowed. We have Peter learning obedience in the boat, learning faith out on the water, learning, you know, kind of to be tough in the garden, but also in the courtyard, running scared. And the last kind of picture I think about Peter is in John 21. I won't go through the whole story, but Jesus has died, and Peter looks at the other disciples and says, "Well, Jesus is gone, so we might as well, I guess, go back to our old way of life. Let's go back fishing." And so the disciples are out on the shore, haven't caught anything again. An image of a person is standing on the shore who says, "Hey, cashing in on the other side." They do. Peter realizes it's Jesus, jumps in the water, clothes and all, swims over to Jesus. Of course, Jesus didn't need the fish. He already had the fish on the fire. And we get this really powerful scene with Peter and Jesus where Jesus says, "Hey, Peter! Do you love me?" "Yeah, Lord, I love you. Of course I do. I didn't call you to fish. I called you to feed my sheep." "Peter, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord, I love you." "Then do the work I called you to do. Feed my sheep." And then he asks a third time. You know, this parallel, right, with the three denials and now this restoration. "Peter, do you love me?" And the Bible says Peter was grieved in his spirit that Jesus asked a third time, "Do you love me?" And Peter said, "Yes, Lord. You know that I love you. Feed my lambs. We have Peter learning obedience in the boat. We have Peter learning faith on the water. We have him acting tough in the garden, running scared in the courtyard. We have him restored on the seashore. Why do I take time to do that? Because I want you to understand the complexities of the writer that writes this book to us. And by the way, the complexities of the people that God calls into His service. He's going to call us to do some very straightforward things. He's going to speak to men and say, "Men, this is how you should act. Husbands, this is how you should act. Fathers, this is what you should do and not do." He's going to talk to women. This is how you should, you know, respond as mother and wife and as in the home. These are the routine of your days, and this is how a Christian lives out their life. And under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Peter is going to say in this letter, these things you should do, these things you should not do. And it's important for me to remember that Peter is not somebody who grew up in an ivory tower speaking these practical truths. He's learned these things the hard way. He was a fisherman, ordinary, in the family business. A lot like people in our own church, in the routine of our days, God laid a hold of us. God laid a hold of Peter. Many of us, too, are quick to speak and fearful. 50% of the time, Peter got it right. 50% of the time, Peter got it wrong. And I think we're probably on the same balance, getting it right and wrong sometimes. Peter is the kind of person that on the one hand, Jesus looked at him one time and was like, "Wow, Peter, yeah, that's right. All of heaven's been waiting for somebody to say it. And there you are, you said it." And then in the next moment, "Peter, get behind me. You're Satan." You know, it's just this paradox of a person who writes this letter. And when he says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ," I think can't help but believe when he writes those words, he writes those words and thinks, "Me? An apostle? Sent out, commissioned for Jesus to do the work of Jesus? A part of this exclusive group of people?" I think it's one of those maybe flooding memories of who he is, who he was. I think also that 1 Peter is a fulfillment of something Jesus said to Peter directly. Jesus said in Luke 22, verse 31, he said, "Peter, Satan has come to me, and Satan wanted to sift you like wheat. But I've prayed for you, and I want you to know that you're going to go through difficulty, and you're actually going to kind of falter away, but you're going to be restored. And Peter, when you're restored," Jesus said this, "I want, after you have returned to me, I want you to strengthen your brethren." And I think 1 and 2 Peter is the fulfillment of Peter strengthening the brethren, both in his day and in our day. It's a reminder to me, just real practically, that he was a failure in a lot of ways, yet he was restored. And in his restoration, he obeyed God and said, "You know what? Really, in a lot of ways, I should be disqualified from doing this work. There's really nothing in me. I mean, I've denied Jesus. I was a hothead. I lived by the motto, shoot, ready, aim. There was really nothing about me that would qualify me for the job of writing these letters and speaking to Christians this discipleship manual of how to live." But God restores the broken. And when God restores the vessel, He's able to use that vessel for His purposes. Our past is in the past. And now the Lord says, the past is something that we think of that strengthens us for the future, right? That I can think about where I came from and be a praising vessel that says, Lord, I'm so grateful I'm not who I used to be, that I am a child of God today and in His family. I have belabored this point with you so that you could see, I think without me even saying these things, but let me just say that the disqualifications that we think about for an individual in the service of Jesus Christ are not stumbling blocks, but they're stepping stones. That God, in His wisdom, as you rehearse the details of your life, and as you look over the days of disappointments and the times and seasons of pain, and as you see all the disappointments you've had in life, and as you look over your life and you really see just what a basket case you are, you really have to conclude that maybe I'm not useful for the kingdom. But if you believe that, looking over your life, I want you to hear this. If you believe that, that's a lie from Satan. The evil one wants you to feel disqualified from doing something for the kingdom of God. He wants to keep you on the sidelines. He doesn't want you to feel useful in Christian service. He wants us to say that the mess of our past disqualifies us from serving Christ. But let us be about the business of having that Philippians 3:14 perspective, where Paul says, forgetting the things that are behind in the past, and learn from them, whether they were success or failure. Forget those things behind. Press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called us heavenward in Christ Jesus. God is in the business of putting people like you and me, warts and all, into the front line of service. It reminds me of one of the lesser known Gaither songs, Something Beautiful. And the first little line goes, something beautiful, something good, all my confusion He understood. All I had to offer Him was brokenness and strife, but God has made something beautiful of my life. And certainly I don't think Peter could get past who he was to understand the complexity of, now I'm an apostle of Jesus. Wow, look at where I came from and look at who I am now. That Jesus would look at Peter and say, Peter, you're my man. You're the one I've chosen to be a vessel for me. I hope you see that you're useful this morning. Whether you're young or old or rich or poor, single, married, or widowed, if you have something or you don't have something, or you have a lot of something and not a lot of another thing, it doesn't matter. God has not called us to sit in blue seats at Parkway Church. This is not the sum of what it means to be a Christian. Although I enjoy seeing you, please. And keep coming back. You know, same time, same channel, next week, right? But He calls us not to come and sit. He calls us to go and be the hands and feet of Jesus. He's called us to something higher. He's called us to be useful for His kingdom, to find our purpose and fulfill it. Peter, he's the writer. And to whom does Peter write? Let me just give you some bullet points, okay? These first readers, this audience given to us in the verses, to the pilgrims of the dispersion. We'll talk about that phrase in a moment. In Pontus, in Galatia, in Cappadocia, in Asia, in Bithynia. If you're taking notes, there's really three things he's talking about here. The first is geographic. And if you were to look at an ancient map, you would find these villages and towns kind of smattered in the region that is modern-day Turkey. And so there's a kind of a geographic. These are little pockets of Christians who have been dispersed for a myriad of different reasons, and now they find themselves in a place that doesn't know who Jesus is, and they've decided they're going to tell people about Jesus. Amen? And so they've taken the truth about Jesus and the resurrection, and now they're going to tell others about Him. And so Peter says, hey, as you live in these various communities that have never seen a Christian, I want them to look at you and know what it means to be a Christian. And by looking at you, they'll say, oh yeah, that is a radically transformed individual from what I am, right? They're not like who I am. They speak differently to their children. They speak differently to their wives. They speak differently, you know, when they go out in the marketplace. You know, they're not about pride and arrogance and these different things. They are a different breed of people. And I want you to know practically what it is to be a Christian so that you can be on display in these communities that have never met a Christian before. He speaks geographically. He also speaks sociologically. And all that means is he calls them pilgrims in this world. Now, I love that word. I think in the NIV it says you're strangers or foreigners. The idea is the same. The idea would be like this. The series is called Exiles, right? These people that have been exiled because of their Christian faith, maybe their business was, you know, they were told they couldn't sell things or their family rejected them, and so they had to go somewhere else. They could not stay in their homeland, their community. And Peter kind of wants us to think, I think, in our minds about the exiles in the Old Testament, where someone from would come into Jerusalem and exile Jews to another country. Think about like in the book of Daniel when the Babylonians come and they, you know, exile Jews back to with Nebuchadnezzar. But they never lost sight of the fact that home was Jerusalem. They might be living in another place, but home is always Jerusalem. And Peter wants us, and he's going to actually explain this later in his book. Listen, Christian, you'll never find your home here on this earth. And you were never meant to find your home here on this earth. You're actually just pilgrims journeying through this earth. Your home is with the Lord God. Your home is in heaven. And so don't get so tied to the things here on earth that you lose sight of the fact that you are actually a citizen of another kingdom. He says, hey, you're pilgrims. And we as Christians need to be reminded of this truth. We have not been sent here by God to be permanent settlers. We have been sent here by God to be temporary residents. Our home is in heaven with the Lord. And we need to be reminded that we don't need to buy in to the world system here. The Bible tells us that, you know, we can grow quite envious and pride and envy and wanting what others have, you know, jealousy and all the rest. I think about like Elon Musk, for instance, who is the richest man in the world at the moment. And I don't know much about his faith background, but I will tell you a warning from Scripture. What does it profit a man to gain the whole world if he's going to lose his soul? What does it profit a man for you to be at the top of the wealthiest people in the world and written down in the Forbes wealthiest list if your name is not written down in the Lamb's Book of Life? And I think we've gotten accustomed to looking at our culture and looking at our culture and saying, hey, guys, we're over here, we're Christians, we're just like you are. There's really no differences. Come and join us and be a part of, you know, just this community of people that are kind of about the same things. And we talk a little bit about Jesus, but hey, we have a lot of fun too. So hey, come on over. No, we are different from people in the world. We are radically different from people in the world. This is not my home. Heaven is my home. I'm just passing through. But that is not the heart of people who are far from God. The pagan heart is tied to the things of earth. They're thinking about what can I build? What can I make? What can I produce? How big can I make my bank account? That's what they're worried about. I'm worried about laying up for myself treasures in heaven, where moth and rust does not corrupt. I'm worried about pleasing my Savior with every breath I take and every word I speak. I'm worried about telling as many people as I know that Jesus Christ is coming again, and you better be ready for that day when He returns. We are different. As the songwriter says, this world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasure's laid up beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door. I can't be at home in this world anymore. And of course, those words, even for the Christian, I think, let me just speak to you honestly, I think that sounds really hollow for many of us. Because I think for many of us in this room, we do feel at home in this world. I don't think the problem is anymore that Christians are no earthly good because they're so heavenly minded. I think the problem is we're no heavenly good because we're so earthly minded. We are trapped. And we need to read and reread and apply and have the Spirit of God write this on our hearts. We are temporary pilgrims here. We are not permanent residents. What the world puts as first importance, we reject. What the world prizes, we do not prize. We are a different people. And then lastly, let me just say that he speaks not only to the geography of where the readers are and the fact that they are pilgrims just passing through this world, but he also speaks to some grand truths that we actually will take a lot of time thinking about over the next few weeks, but here I'm just going to give you to you in bullets, the theological. You notice he says here, you are the elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. This marks us further out as a peculiar people because God has purposed to have a people of His very own. It is unearned and undeserved, and it is a gift that only God can offer, and He freely offers it to whosoever will believe. Later on in the next chapter, we're going to find out who this people is, who we are as Christians. In verse 9 of chapter 2, he says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, His own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of the darkness into His marvelous light. These three things are true of every Christian. The first, every Christian is elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. As Free Will Baptists, we believe that each individual person has the free will to choose or reject God's offer of salvation. And that God's offer of salvation is always available. That when the Holy Spirit can move onto the heart and mind of an individual, when the Word of God is opened, when preaching happens, when a Christian friend has a conversation, when they are confronted by something in a billboard, anything, God can use anything. And it can be a moment when the Holy Spirit says, hey, I'm calling you. And then in those moments of calling, a person can choose or reject that free offer of salvation. What does it mean then that we are elect by the foreknowledge of God? It means that God, who is infinite in His wisdom and all that He knows and sees, He sees from eternity past to eternity future, and He knows the individuals who will choose to accept this gift of salvation. And truly, we can say just what the Scripture says, that before the foundations of the world were laid, we were on the mind and heart of God because He saw into the future. He saw everyone in this room and the decisions we would make. My name has been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life for a very, very long time. I am reminded that as being a part of the elect, that is a humbling moment because I don't earn it and I don't deserve it. Every Christian can sing, I know not why God's wondrous grace to me hath been made known, nor why, unworthy as I am, that Christ in love would redeem me for His own. But I do know this, I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that He is able to keep that which I have committed unto Him until that day. We're going to deal with that in our study. And then He says that we are sanctified by the Spirit. We'll talk about that in our study. And we're also going to think about this other characteristic of a Christian, sanctified by the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. We initially are saved and cleansed of our during that moment of salvation when we become a child of God. And each and every day when we go through life, we need that continual cleansing. We'll talk about that as Peter describes it later on in his book. And the last phrase that he gives us in these first few verses, grace to you and peace be multiplied. I think that's a wonderful phrase. You ask me, you know, Pastor Jamie, what do I need tomorrow, you know, at work? Grace and peace be multiplied. What do I do with my horrible boss? You need grace and peace to be multiplied. What if I am the horrible boss? You need grace and peace to be multiplied for the people who work for you. You know, what do I do at home when the kids are, you know, going crazy? You need grace and peace to be multiplied. What about the wife, the husband, whatever? You need grace and peace to be multiplied to you. Grace and peace. Now, over the next few weeks, I don't know how long it's going to take us. We're going to work ourselves through 1 Peter, and we're going to see these practical things. And again, these are not high and lofty theological things. These are just where rubber meets the road. Hey, do this, Christian. Don't do this, Christian. And we're going to see that as we explore the book of 1 Peter. Maybe this morning you've been reminded that God has not disqualified you from His service, that sitting in blue padded chairs at Parkway Church is not what God has called you to do. He has called you to be His hands and His feet and to find your purpose and to live that out each and every day. That God has called this church to be on mission to help other people find their life and purpose in Jesus, and that you need to be about that mission too as you go throughout your days. Maybe you've been reminded that no matter where you go and what you do, you're just traveling through this place. And you don't need to be a part of this world's system to value what the world values. You need to be about Christ and listening to His still small voice. Seek Him and be more like Him as you journey through this world, so that you too can be on display in a community like Galatia, where they didn't have a lot of Christians, but they got to see a Christian on display and said, hey, there's something different about those kind of Christians. Let's pray. Father God, we come before You and we thank You, Lord, for giving us Your Word and Your truth.